a sense. Recording in progress. I just pressed something called got it. All right. So in a sense, what we are talking about as Mumbai, you know, right now, what the images that we are going to be sharing with you right now, I will keep saying next. And I suppose, Madhu, you'll be able to keep moving the slides forward. But look at them as images from Mumbai, but consider them as images not only that represent India, but represent the whole planet, that represent the whole biosphere. Because there is not a whit of difference between the laws of the biosphere that apply to us on Pedder Road, on Malabar Hill, on Sanjay Gandhi National Park, or Andheri, or the coast, that do not also equally apply to the Amazon or to the Great Barrier Reef. It's exactly the same rules that apply. We are essentially bumped up monkeys. But somehow or the other, that intelligence that was gifted to us, it's gone slightly wonky, you know. We've begun to believe we are the gods that we've invented. And things like this horrible, awful pandemic that has caused so much tragedy and so much trauma in all our lives. It's come as a warning. And to an audience like this, the one I'm speaking to now, I have no doubt that what I say will resonate with you, because it's not that I am so good that I can say something to resonate. It is your feeling. You are sensitive human beings, or you would not be members of the Asiatic Society. You seek knowledge, you seek to expand your minds, and you want to be productive citizens. In truth, I must confess, the images I'm showing you are the images I show to 12-year-olds and 14-year-olds. They are really my constituency. And with them, Kids for Tigers, Sanctuary Nature Foundation runs a program across the country. Yes, we reach 1 million children with the butterfly touch. But it is in truth less a children's education program and more an adult literacy program. Because one of the first things we tell children is, whatever you learn today, go back and speak to your parents. Go back and speak to your uncles, your aunts, your brothers, your friends, your other people. Because there's nobody who has a greater legitimacy to ask for a better tomorrow than our children. And that is really the crux of the whole issue of this question. Oh, you environmentalists are coming in the way of development, and development is required to give jobs, and you people are really slowing us down. It answers the question that when the British left in 1947, we thought the era of colonization had gone. But in the interests of communicating knowledge and reality, let me tell you that in 1947, in real earnest, the process of colonization had only just begun, because the British never had the resources and the tools. They had money, and they had ships, and they had the ability to get so many thousands and thousands of people to do things. And they built railways straight from our forest to the ports so that they could take the timber out and they could use that timber to build their armadas, you know. Today, we are embarked on what I would call not just the greatest, but possibly the ultimate or the penultimate adventure. It's called intergenerational colonization. And if we do not understand, if individuals such as yourselves, who are part of a knowledge-based, a knowledge-promoting organization like the Asiatic Society, don't take it upon yourself just to communicate to everybody what the actual situation is, what the value of our natural resources are, and what the consequences of allowing people to destroy these natural resources is, then I think we will have failed what our founders, the founders of India, of our constitution. I'm a member of the Bombay Natural History Society. You all are members of the Asiatic Society. All the people who created these institutions, they created them so that we could live better lives, we could have cleaner air, we could be blessed by nature, because all our inspiration. There are more than 100,000 books that are part of the Asiatic Library, you know, its collections. All these books, whether they are with the Asiatic society, or whether they were written as the Upanishads, or whether they were written as whatever, they were inspired in some sense by the natural processes of this planet. Our art, our culture, our songs, our music, our dance, our religions, our thought, our relationships, our societies were all inspired by nature. I don't know anybody who could kill the source of their inspiration and still believe that they are having either a good life, and in this case, as we will learn as we go along over the next half an hour or so, even a life itself. Because please believe me, we human beings, Homo sapiens, are the most dangerous animals on earth. Not that tiger you see behind me. That tiger is just a metaphor. It's a metaphor for all of nature. That tiger could be a tiger, I could have a polar bear there, I could have a giraffe there, I could have a lion there, I could have an elephant there, I could have a mosquito there. They all have an equally important role to play in the biosphere. And this is what I hope to convey in the process of this evening, because in my reckoning, the connection, the umbilicus between living and non-living heritage is absolute. And at this moment in time, who knows how many of the future books that will be written by the kids who are now 14, 15, 16, perhaps some of the Buddha party like me, even the books we write will write about the fact that we are going through a period of such transition that we have come to a point where we are now the agents of geologic change. What used to take 100,000 years or 10,000 years for sea levels to rise and climate to change is now happening within 50 years, 60 years. The analogy I would give, and I'll stop with analogies there and go on to the picture, is that if you had to cross Marine Drive and you saw a car coming something like 30 meters away or 40 meters away, you shouldn't do that because it's dangerous, but you could possibly just jump across the divider and get to the other side. But suppose the car that you thought was driving at 30, 40, 50 kilometers were driving at 400 kilometers. You'd be flattened like a bug. That is the analogy that works for the pace at which we are causing a climate wobble and we are changing the course of the biosphere's ability to sustain life. All of this could happen. All the species that we see, that you will see and you, I will share with you now, these could very well adapt to the changes we are doing if we put them in slow motion, and instead of doing these, making these changes in 30 years or 40 years or 100 years, we said, okay, let it be in 10,000 years. Then the species could have adapted and adjusted. So may we have the first slides, please. Naturally, Mumbai. Or we could say Mumbai naturally. You know something? We have the finest coastline imaginable. I've been to San Francisco, and I'll tell you, our coastline is far better. We have a far better coastline, but we don't have a greater appreciation for our coastline than the citizens of San Francisco who celebrate their coastline. And it's not just the coastline. Are we able to see the pictures? I don't see any picture on my screen.
Yeah, me neither. I don't know. Something is...
Well.
Yes, sir.
I see the first slide. You have to just move it to the second one.
Yes.
Ah, there we are. You see? You've not only moved it to the second one, but you've got yourself an idea of why we talk of Mumbai naturally. Look, it is incredible. I had gone to a very major conference in Johannesburg, and there were people from all over the world that had come there. And they had made presentations. It was about cities and biodiversity and things like this. And I'd gone there with just one slide projector that they gave me and one tray of slides. And the rest of them had 8 projector projections, and they had screens, and they had 4 screens. And when I thought, what on earth is doing? Have I made a mistake? I mean, what exactly is happening? But to cut that long story short, when they talked about nature in their city, The one that impressed everybody the most was Central Park in New York. And it was beautifully done with music, and it had trees, and it had pathways, and it had people walking quietly. It had old people walking. It had young people enjoying themselves. And at the end of that session, immediately after that was mine, there was almost a standing ovation that in the middle of the city of New York, you can have a 30-plus acre wilderness like this, a wild, wild place like this. And then I came on and spoke about Sanjay Gandhi National Park. And I didn't mean to be, you know, sort of showing off, dekho who I am, etc. But I did start by saying, you know, I could fit 37 Central Parks into my one Sanjay Gandhi National Park in the heart of Mumbai. And here we don't keep our leopards behind cages. There are some of them behind cages, sadly, but we have got over 15, 17, 18 leopards free ranging. And we know how to live with nature because we are a people who were born of cultures that venerated not only nature, but venerated all the species that got together and composed nature. So let me tell you this, that Bombay, Mumbai is a destination not just visited by tourists and by residents, but by birds as well, and by turtles, and by all manner of creatures from across the oceans. Next slide. You know, it seems almost inevitable. Can we move the slides a little? Yeah, there we are. That's just to give you a very bird's eye view. It's a Google map. And way up north, there's a little green spot. And there you have the Sanjay Gandhi National Park and the other patches of green. Those are the patches where you will see, no matter which species it is, if it can find a way, like where I live in Malabar Hill, and Darshan Khatau, who's also here, he lives on the Rajbhavan side, and I'm living on the Parsi Agyari side here. I mean, we share the most wonderful things. Peacocks, peafowl, they come here. The orioles come here. The spotted owlets come here. The mongoose comes here. Creatures will find the smallest spots of green that you give them because they are survivors. They will survive with whatever you give them. And if we don't give them the right things, well, then they just vanish. Next slide. And this business of they just vanish is not just a, oh my God, poor little animal, it's gone. That's not it. These are the gardeners of our Eden. Ye hamare van ke mali hai. Without them, believe me, human beings are the world's worst tree planters. We don't know how to plant trees. When we plant trees, we actually destroy what is natural in nature. I'm not saying that as an absolute statement. I'm saying that because if you take institutions like the World Bank, etc., I have been at meetings and I've been at loggerheads with the World Bank for 40 years. They originally started with forestry projects where they said, you know, Indian forests don't have the productivity that is required for a growing country like India. We will put down trees that will actually give us timber, and that will be something that will not just enrich this, but it will be wonderful and blah, 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 blah. And all I said was, who arrogated to you the responsibility of making India more natural by cutting its natural forests and planting teak and tropical pine and wattle and eucalyptus? This is not the India we know. We will unlikely to worship those because they cannot support the creatures that we also worship. So now here we are. You know, Sanjay Gandhi National Park is not a park, it's a miracle. The fact is that irrespective of the fights we might have and the court cases we might fight and the differences we might have, successive governments over the past XYZ number of years have actually allowed, and I say allowed very carefully, this parcel of 104 acres to actually be protected and not be built upon like the cities that you see, the city that you see behind you. Next. And I will rush through parts of this, but and I may stop at parts of this. It's not just Mumbai. If you go through Thane, if you go through Nasik, if you go around Mumbai, around here, even going further south, this is the start of the Western Ghats, one of the most amazing biodiversity hotspots in the whole wide world. You know, we are blessed. मैं हिंदी में जब बात करता हूँ इन बच्चों के साथ तो मैं उनको ये कहता हूँ कि ये कोई जायदाद नहीं है जो हम लोगों बुड्ढा पार्टी ने बच्चा पार्टी को दिया ये एक विरासत है. There's a difference, you know. It's not an inheritance, it's heritage. The members of the Asiatic society will understand the difference. We are custodians, and that's not a cliche. That's a fact. I have no right to take away these forests, because these forests, apart from looking beautiful and making your blood pressure come down and making you feel good and taking away the depression that everybody is suffering from in larger or smaller degrees, these are our infrastructures of survival. These are what make our air clean. These are what hold our water. The next slide, the forests of the Sanjay Gandhi National Park, incidentally, what you're seeing right now is taken, a lovely guy called Gaurav Shirodkar took this picture, probably from Bhut Bangla, you know, way up in the Sanjay Gandhi National Park on top of a hill, where, by the way, it's now a core area, so nobody can go. But when we were allowed to go, there's a broken down old structure that is now called Bhut Bangla. But there's a small inscription written by some Englishman. I couldn't make out what it was. But there was a bathtub there. A lovely little bathtub that he had built for his wife, you know, to come down and have a bath here. I mean, I'm talking about this to say that there was a time even those who were exploiting the forest understood the value of the forest, and they understood the peace that comes with being in a forest. And if I had anything that I wanted to do for our children, it would be to gift them the kind of relationship that I had, or, you know, so many of the people who are on this talk this evening had, where you could go to a forest and you could sit and you could go, and you were not going like a peep show. Tiger dekha, nahi dekha, are, tiger nahi dekha. But the guy saw a wild dog, he saw a leopard, he saw all manner of creatures. But if he didn't see a tiger, he said, paisa vasool nahi. So this idea of reaching children right now and going out and talking to them about living heritage and telling them how this living heritage has created all else is nothing but to change a generation's direction. We lost our way. We never fought for freedom. My generation never fought for freedom. We took it for granted, and we have now become the colonizers of the ultimate adventure, which is intergenerational colonization. And when the books are written, when the art is produced, this will be the story told of our generation. It will not be told that how lovely they were. They made so many five-star hotels. They made so many bridges. They made so many 10-lane highways. They made buildings that go up to 200. What will be written about us is they stole our future. They had a chance to stop it, and they did not stop it. Poetry will be written like that. Stories will be written like that. Fiction will be produced like that. Films will be produced like that. And let's go to the next slide. What you're seeing is Bihar and then Tulsi, then it goes into Pawai, and from Pawai, the water that goes through gets to that beautiful river that was once home to flamingos, Mithi, you know, and now it's turned into a Ganda Nala. But here is the coastline of Mumbai. Darshan, I'm sorry that there are none of your pictures in this particular presentation, but how I wish I had thought to put at least 4 or 5 of them. Nevertheless, I'm sure you can share them with the Asiatic Society and send them out or give them links. But look, every creature that you see here, this crab, for instance, he cleans the shores. Anything dead or dying, munches it up, turns it back, crushes it up, and then it becomes something that allows fish to eat. It allows the beach to be cleaned. It allows us to live safely. Next. It is ringed. Mumbai is ringed. There is no place on earth you can go to other than Mumbai to see 70,000 flamingos in the heart of a city. Our Airoli, you know, the flamingo sanctuary there. I don't know how to explain to you what the value is. And I wish I could explain to the managers and the planners and all the people. Our doors, those doors are normally shut to us, but they are open to the builders who consume these places. You have to go to Lake Nakuru to see this. I promise you, if you take your children to see flamingos, like I took my grandchildren, I had 3 grandsons. At that point, they were 9, they were 8, and they were 6 years old. And you know what they were talking amongst themselves without talking to me? You know, it looks as though somebody has put strawberry ice cream all over the water. And I said to myself that, look, strawberry ice cream makes them happy. This sight makes them happy. That is what we should do. We should allow the flamingos to stay. And if we are not able to do that, please don't disguise human ambition, false human ambition, as development. That is not development. Next slide. Oh, there's the rules, as I said, are very, very clear. Very, very clear. It's eat or be eaten in the forests of this. It's even in your home, behind one of your art paintings or whatever you've got there, you probably will find a small gecko that's eating the cockroaches that also come out at night. The rules are the same. Next slide. I'm going to go through the slides a little quicker so that you can get an idea of what the potential is. And if I can ask you to pretend that you're 12 years old again, then please understand that when somebody my age talks to 12-year-olds, I have no right to present them with a problem that they have no hope of ever solving. And I have no right to tell them a lie either. Oh, everything is fine. Don't worry. Life is good. The sun comes up. The moon comes up. Don't worry. You're okay. The murky air you're breathing is fine. No, I have to tell them the truth. But I have to give them hope. And that hope cannot be false hope. So here we are. What you're seeing here is the Mahim Nature Park. 40 years plus ago, the WWF, a wonderful organization that was started with the simple idea to protect wildlife. There was a lady called Shanta Chatterjee, and she had it in her mind to take this area, which you see now as a forest with a little white building in the middle. And it was one of Asia's largest landfill garbage dumps. And it was turned into a forest, not so much that all these trees were not planted. Some trees were planted, plastic was taken out, it was decontaminated to the extent we could. And at that point, what happened was the birds began to come, the gardeners of Eden, Hamare Van Ke Mali. A bird came and dropped a piece of shit, and inside that there was a seed, and that seed grew up, and the butterflies came, and the bees came, and the beetles came, and the squirrels came, and these were the gardeners of Eden. They made this park. All we did was we gave it a push start, like gaadi band ho jati hai, toh in the carburetor you put a little bit of petrol, and then it starts, and then it kinchos from the tank. Well, the tank actually belongs to all the other creatures, the gardeners of our Eden. And that is the rationale. And it is as important for us to make Mumbai green as it is for us to protect Kanha or Ranthambore or Bandhavgarh or Corbett or Nagarhole or any one of these parks, you know. Next slide. This is only a rough estimate. As you can see, 1,000 species, it might be 1,200, it might be 1,900 and something. We even the plants, proper documentation has not fully been done. Despite, Blatter's herbarium and wonderful human beings who spent their whole lives counting, there is so much yet to be discovered. 1,000 plants, 43 species of mammals, 45 species of reptiles, 283 birds, 150 species of butterflies. We haven't even started going to the fish. We haven't started documenting what you see, but you will see octopus. You will see moray eels. If you go down to the ocean shore, and if you're lucky enough and you actually get to see Darshan's pictures, you'll see pods of dolphins coming here. You'll find duck coming here. You'll find all manner of creatures. We are living in a blessed, blessed, blessed city. It is so wonderful. Somebody let Sunil Jhaveri in. He's in the waiting room, by the way. So, next slide. You know, the thing here is, what do we do? I said that pretend that you're 12 years old. So let me continue the 12-year-old story. Kids love this. Even adults sort of feel that, oh, just another peacock. But what I tell the children is, wouldn't you like to live in a magic home? The doors are made of chocolate. The windows are made of lollipops. When you turn on the tap, you get meetha meetha lemonade. Every stone is a sweet. And when you go to sleep, brrr karke next morning, it's back again. Everything is magic. Would you like that magic home? And the kids say, yes, Bittu uncle, we would love to have a magic home. And I said, but suppose somebody came and wanted to take your magic home away and destroy it. And there would be really consternation on their faces. And they'd say, no, Bittu uncle. But I said, but every langur lives in a magic home. He lives in the tree, it's his home, and he eats it also. And he eats the fruit and he comes back. And then it comes back again to life. Doesn't happen overnight, but it happens the next monsoon. Children understand it like that, that nature is self-repairing. And then I ask them, has anybody got cut on their elbow or their forehead or their knee? And they say, yes, Bittu uncle, see you over here. And somebody with a patti will put his hand up and say, listen, the mother put the patti because your mother loves you. The same way as Mother Nature loves you. And at this point, we tell them that, look, all of you, you know, you've got superheroes, you've got Batman, you've got Superman, you've got Iron Man, you've got this man, you've got Hanuman. But the greatest superhero of the whole lot of them is Mother Nature. And Mother Nature can fix everything. And that's how their psyche is protected. They must not get the impression that nothing can be fixed again. Even though we human beings, we adults, are misbehaving and mismanaging our planet, the truth is that nature is even reducing our ability to do that. Darshan, you're in the business of finance and things, and you must know now that the younger generation that growing up do not want to finance oil, coal, gas. They're looking to finance non-carbon energy. They're looking to have efficiency. And that is the hard truth. Next slide. And I'll tell you this, that all the organizations that work for, you know, for children's rights, for human rights, for health, if we don't look after the karvi flower, if we don't look after the bees that pollinate it and the butterflies that come to it and the other creatures that depend on it, then we have misunderstood the purpose of life. We can easily restore everything by just leaving it alone and stopping doing the damage. And in the process, we are likely to give millions and millions of jobs and livelihoods. Next slide. I will explain to you how and what nature is forcing an alteration of the human ambition. And it is changing the definition of the word development for us. All the debates that take place between human beings, what is development, what is destruction. Bhadme jai wo sab. At this moment in time, if I was you, I would take my money out of any carbon investment I make, because you're going to lose money there. That is the slowest, most risky investment. Even insurance companies are not ready to now invest in accept in, you know, risk premium that for industries that don't have a future. These banyan trees, you know, this is what Mumbai used to be, and this is what Mumbai can still be. Maybe not in my lifetime, but it can start. Next slide. These are infrastructures. Every tree is an air conditioner. And what you see over here, you know, everybody loves to feed pigeons with grain and this and that. And we have actually got too many pigeons because of that. But then there's a control also coming. Some of the cats will take. And this one, what you see here is a peregrine falcon. Something that people travel way far away to different destinations to see. But it's lying right here. Quietly goes, picks up a pigeon, sits in a balcony and eats. Laws of the jungle are still alive. Next. Oh my gosh, I could go on and on. You know, this particular thing, an Atlas moth, it doesn't even have any mouthparts to feed. It doesn't feed. It stays as in its early form as a caterpillar earlier when it does feed. And then its purpose is to grow up, procreate, and then die. And it's the largest moth in the world. This is a miracle. People would travel halfway across the world just to see this moth, but we must first understand what the value of this moth or those flamingos is. Next. You know, the best habitat for this butterfly or that tiger behind me or the flamingos or the crab is the human heart right now, because we have the power to wipe these out to a large extent, not all of them, but we can actually wipe this out to the extent where our lives could be very uncomfortable. And there's no need to do that. Our job is to see that our children, and children don't do what you tell them to do, they do what you do. Our job is to see that in our own homes, we do the right thing. So if somebody, you're sitting in a car and he spits out of the window, believe me, that child will go up thinking that's fine. If he takes a cigarette packet and throws it out, shouldn't be smoking in the first place. That's what the child will do, throw a chocolate wrapper out. So we tell the children, next slide, you've got magic eyes. No? Hum log budde hai na, kabhi humko dikhai nahi deta, sunai nahi deta. So you just pick up, but be very polite. Say, uncle, you dropped something. Maybe you might need it at home, you know. And the elders understand ki maine galti ki, but the children, they have magic eyes. They have magic hearts. What you see here, by the way, is magic too. This is, you know, it is a blue oak leaf butterfly. And it looks like a leaf when it's together, when its wings are folded. It has to also find a boyfriend, girlfriend. So when it opens its wings out, in a flash, it will show you the blue and come back. These are all ways to survive. the trials of life. Next slide. This is the magic we show children. They sit sometimes for 5 minutes. And these dragonflies that you see, can you believe that this tiny little thing like this, brr brr karke jo urti hai humare yahan, first of all, by the way, they are mosquito eaters, you know. They are the tigers of the sky. They're major predators, but they fly from India to Africa across the ocean. This is how nature has evolved and treated them. And what are we doing? We are pouring toxins and poisons and wo fog wagaira laga dete hain, which is only really little more than a psychological aid ki bhai dekho humne dhuan phenk diya 5 minute ke baad to wo dhuan to kha gaya hawa kha gayi usko but beech mein kya ho jata hai ki if it doesn't directly kill a dragonfly it will the dragonfly through eating the organisms that have imbibed those persistent organic pollutants it will kill their ability to survive and procreate by getting so scared of nature by first creating the circumstances in which we have overpopulation of one species and then we use poison to reduce the population of that species we are actually destroying ourselves and the biosphere next slide this is knowledge in its own form and some people will take this knowledge and turn it into poetry and frankly if you ask me it's not the engineers it's not the bankers it's not the businessmen it's not the definitely not the politicians it's not the bureaucrats it's the artists it's the thinkers it's the writers it's the poets it's the philosophers the singers the dancers the performers these are the people who sow seeds of human ambition which is that I was born I am temporary I must have a good life I must cause as little pain as possible and I must find happiness in other people's happiness and it is my duty to be happy every day of my life that's not mine That's the philosophy of the Dalai Lama, His Holiness, who told me once after we were talking about all kinds of misery that he was facing, you know, in Tibet and this and that. And I was saying, Your Holiness, some of the orange-robed priests of yours, the monks, they're taking tiger bones underneath and going for the horse festival. So the meeting was late. That's why we had a one-on-one. And when the bell went ting, I felt a tap on my shoulder. And he said, he lisps slightly. He has a beautiful way of speaking. Don't worry, everything will be all right, he said. But it is your duty to be happy every day of your life. It is the gift of life. Don't be guilty if you are eating and somebody doesn't have share a little bit. That's all. That's all India needs. We don't need much more than that. That's what America needs. That's what the European Union needs. Everybody needs just to be able to live and let live the way that the creatures that we see. Next slide. Every creature has been given. This is you know, a carpenter bee. It has the ability. I cannot, for the world of me, understand how it can actually, this bee can drill through, can make, excavate wood. And it is unbelievable, but it will still come for the nectar. And the flowers, by the way, at one time, the earth was all green. There were no flowers. But when the flying insects came about, the plants, we say that they are inanimate objects, or rather that they don't have any intelligence, but they had enough intelligence to produce colors, ultraviolet colors, and nectar and essences to tell these bees, "Ow, ow, 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 main aapko kuch khilata hoon, khilate hoon." And from there, he takes it, and the pollination takes place, which my 12 years old understands straight away. Next slide. Everything is magical in this universe. This is a praying mantis. It's called a praying mantis because it holds its front four limbs together. And in a flash, it can pick up something. These are all the wonders of nature. These are all the species that exist. There's not a niche that won't be filled at some point, whether it's in the Marianas Trench with the tube worms or whether it's on the top of Mount Everest. Every species will have some way to survive. And every species listens to the way and the laws of nature, not because they read the laws, but if they don't listen, they die. So only the survivors that you see today are the ones that have learned to obey. Human beings are the only ones that know but will refuse to obey because we think we have become the gods that we invented. Next. Oh, what shall I tell you about this character? You know, looks beautiful with that lovely blue shimmering thing and all. Can you go to the next slide and you'll see the harsher part? This is in one form. It's an antlion. You know those little volcano, inverted volcanoes that you see sometimes in mud? Any ant or anything that comes there, it's so slippery, it's so dry, that it comes down and it slips down, and at which point these pincers will pick it up. Such wondrous mechanisms to survive and to procreate. Next slide. All these are taken in Mumbai. None of these pictures have been taken outside. They're all from Mumbai. Now, look at this. You take the giant wood spider. If you walk through Sanjay Gandhi National Park, at some point or the other, we try to avoid the webs, but these webs are sometimes 10 and 15 feet wide, you know. So there you have it. It's a spider. And by the way, the female is large and the male is possibly just as large as one segment, the yellow part of its body, of its leg, you know. But, and the male has to tap on that web, a signal, ki main male ho, main makhi nahi ho, mujhe khao mat. But kai dafe agar uski tap, 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 theek nahi hoti, wo bhi khaya jata hai. Kudrat mein cruelty nahi hoti hai, survival hota hai. And everybody listens to rules, including the males listen to the females. That is probably what human beings will have to start doing also. Next. Darshan, you know, there was a big argument that this is called stabilimenta. You know, those zigzaggy white things that you see. Stabilimenta is supposed to be stabilizing the web, but it's not that. This stabilimenta was created to warn birds that there's a web here. If a bird comes and hits this web, the spider has to put out so much protein to make another web, and the bird has to go and clean its feathers. So this next slide, now we're going to really run through. I wanted to end about now. But basically, spiders, they don't have chewing parts in their mouth. Their venom is a digestive juice. It bites it, it turns the inside into soup. And this particular fellow, this tarantula, we've seen them, we know where they are, but we don't tell most people. But when we take children, we show it to them. There's a little trap door. It opens the trap door when it hears something coming. Suppose it's a small little beetle or something going, jhap karke le jata hai, andar jata hai, kha deta hai, that's it. This is the magic. And this is what we show children. And they go back with stories to tell their parents. Next. As we tell the children, you know, in the children's language, it looks like it's a battle tank, but actually it's not just a war machine. It's actually like a pram. Those are all baby scorpions on the back. And just the way that a mother looks after his children, the scorpion looks after its young. Next, all these creatures live in the one place that we have decided to protect called Sanjay Gandhi National Park. And aaj ke din mein, meri generation jo hai, Buddha Party, अरे मुझे थोड़ा चाहिए 4 acre चाहिए 8 acre चाहिए 12 acre चाहिए, एक रोड बनाना है, एक रोपवे बनाना है, एक सड़क बनानी है, अरे एक टूरिज्म सेंटर बनाना है, मुझे ये करना है, मुझे वो. मैं बोलता हूँ यार क्या करते हो. सपोज इन द ताजमहल यू वांट टू बिल्ड अ यूरिनल, यू डोंट गो टू वेयर मुमताज महल इज, मुमताज बेगम इज देयर, यू गो एंड बिल्ड इट, यू साइट इट इन द करेक्ट प्लेस. व्हाई डू यू वांट टू टेक द स्मॉल पीसेस ऑफ हेवन दैट वी हैव एंड टर्न देम इनटू हेल. यू नो, this is something that children understand, and they often ask me, Bittu uncle, jab inko pata hai tha, why are they still doing it? And I really have no answer. Next. I go to sleep. I live on Malabar Hill, and I can tell you, I keep the windows open at night, and I go to sleep with an orchestra of frogs and toads these days, and I wake up to an orchestra of birds. Kingfishers come. I mean, you name it. Darshan has got 10 times more pictures. I've seen owlets also here, when Darshan is photographing families of owlets where he is. But I'll tell you this, that every single part of Mumbai should have a small wilderness, even if it is 30 square meters. Because over there, you will have bird song instead of hearing car horns, ka, 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 ka. And every tree is an air conditioner, and every leaf on every tree is a dust collector, and it improves your lungs. It improves yourself. If nothing else, stare at it for 5 minutes. Your blood pressure will come down, your heartbeat will come down, you'll be happier. Next slide. Everywhere. Next slide, you get the idea. These control, you know, Humayun Abdul Ali is passed away. He was one of the builders with Salim Ali of the Bombay Natural History Society, and the French came to us and said, export frog's legs. This was at a time when India had futti kodi nahi thi, no foreign exchange. And he said, not on my, I will rather die than let you export this, because you will cause malaria to happen, because they eat their body weight in insects every day and mosquitoes. Next. I wouldn't go close to that snake. I would let it be. It's a common crate. It's one of the most venomous snakes there, but the snake keeps the frog population in check. Human beings are very dirty in their habits. We throw organic food around that creates dogs. The dogs are eaten by leopards, and also rats come, and these guys control the rats. There's a balance in nature. Next slide. A complete balance. I mean, this is, I wouldn't even try to pronounce this, but I'm okay, I might try. Cryptodactylus Varadgiri. Varadgiri is one of the finest scientists we have. Fantastic guy. He's now, this gecko was named after him, but all these creatures have their own special function in life. Next slide. What you see here, this crocodile that you see, the marsh crocodile, its ancestors lived when the dinosaurs were around. In their genetic memory, they know that dinosaurs were around in some form or the other. I mean, they are survivors, but they don't know how to survive the most dangerous animal in the world, that is Homo sapiens. I actually would like to rename us Homo stupidus, because we are cutting the branch on which we live, all as all the old stories tell. Next. We're coming towards the end of this. Turtles, every creature has a function, and everything, every last millimeter of this creature has been designed to perfection to allow it to survive. It eats all the rotten material and turns it into something useful. And when it poops, that poop is eaten by fish, and it's a permanent cycle. And please, my heart jod ke kehta hun logon ko, ki please don't use the expression from, cradle to grave. They think that they're doing such a wonderful thing. Cradle to grave, we look after the environment. Are cradle to cradle hota hai, bevkoof. Cradle to grave nahi hota hai. Agar cradle to grave hota, toh we would not be around, So cradle to cradle is basically that we should be able to live our lives in such a way that if not us, other creatures should be able to eat and survive on what our waste is. There is no creature in the whole world other than Homo sapiens that has the technology to waste. And that is one of the biggest problems of the city and of agriculture for that matter. Next. You can well imagine, we can go to the next one. This is an oriental garden lizard. Oh my God, if you haven't seen the flamingos, you haven't lived in Mumbai. They will be going away now. Monsoon ke time mein, there's too, sea is too rough. But I tell you, if you can see something like this, kiss. Intelligent brain mein aisa kaha tha ki ei mud flat ke upar building banao. I mean, how much? There are limits to growth, Even I like growth. I want my child to grow up to be 16, 17 years old. But after 17, I don't want the child to keep growing. And, uncontrolled growth after a point when you have now settled yourself, it's called cancer. And now we are behaving like a cancer upon the biosphere. And the biosphere will sort us out, whether it's through a pandemic or whether it's through shortage of water or something. Next slide. We can go on. The mangroves are there. The buildings are there. The Thane Creek is a magical, magical place. Next slide. The kingfisher that wakes me every morning, as you can see, I think it's got itself a nice crab. Sometimes next day it'll have a, and here you have an Asian paradise flycatcher. Next slide. Look at the diversity that we have. This is the butcher bird, It's a shrike, and what it does is it takes a bird, insect swarm. So it picks it up and then pokes it down on a thorn, and it goes, and because it can't follow the swarm, so it kills 8 or 10 insects at one time and then has a beautiful feast after the swarm has gone. Next. This hornbill was taken by Darshan Khatau. This was the one thing that I could actually find last minute and put it in Darshan. But the fact is that it's eating figs from a banyan tree. And we are now getting a small population of these birds which decorate our lives. And we have got wonderful human beings who document these, and they decorate our lives too and remind us that life is beautiful for all the misery that the television keeps pouring out into your heads and hearts and into your children's minds. Take them out when the pandemic allows. Let them just sit next to the sea. Let them just sit next to a forest like the Sanjay Gandhi National Park or in Malabar Hill or wherever, and life will become better. Next. Heart-spotted woodpecker. Next. My word, the purple sunbird, it is beautiful. And look at the beak. You know, the beak has been made in such a way that it can access the nectar perfectly. Next, Darwin wrote about this. These mongoose, I don't know, my children asked me, Pitu uncle, why don't we call them mongoose? So I said, look, I don't know, but I'd say mongooses. But it's a bit, sometimes the children are most beautiful because they ask you questions you don't know how to answer. Then you go into the Google, ask Mr. Google. Next slide. You know, everything is cyclical, you know. The wild boars can actually wipe out a farmer's entire crop in one night. And if there were no carnivores to keep their populations down, believe me, there would be no farmers, there would be no food. Everything has a balance. Next. In Sanjay Gandhi National Park, you have this. It's a mouse deer. Small little creature like that. And it's called the chevrotain. But next slide. You have such beautiful things. One of the world's smallest wild cats also is here, called the rusty spotted cat. Chital, they are like walking fast food for the tigers and for leopards. Next slide. Jackals, you'll find them in the mangroves. Mumbai is stocked full of wildlife for those who have eyes to see. Next. This is a picture of your Mumbai. And that leopard, it lives in the Sanjay Gandhi National Park. It lives in the RA Milk Colony. And the city behind it is so dependent upon these. At one time, 100% of our water came from there. Then we kept drowning forests far and far and far and far. Now, 100 kilometers away from Modak Sagar and this Sagar and that Sagar, we are bringing water down. But the fact is that Mumbai wastes half the water that it collects. The next investments, the investment bankers should invest in efficiency and making sure that we have a smaller footprint, not only by shifting from, you know, carbon energy to non-carbon energy, but also by reducing waste, consume less. Happiness is not consuming more in a mall. Happiness is being able to sit and watching your children smile. Next. So this is it. You find all these creatures. This is actually... Half of the things I've talked to you about have been taught to me by the Bombay Natural History Society and all-time greats there, and by Salim Ali, and by Baba Amte, and by wonderful poets like Sugatha Kumari, and people like this who understood that nature was life. And that's the end of that's the last slide, if I'm not mistaken. See if there's one more, I don't know. But remember, if you keep magic eyes open, the wonderful world of nature exists at your very doorstep. And I can assure you that is true. If you don't believe me, at the end of this, ask Darshan Katao. He will tell you. Next. And I'll tell you this one last story about myself, which will take 30 seconds. I had gone to Ranthambore and met a man called Fateh Singh Rathore for 6-7 years. And then I, on the 6th or the 7th year, I said, Fateh, I'm feeling guilty. Yaar, main yahan aake mauj kar raha hu. Aap jaake jhagda karte ho, logon se bachate ho. What can I do to save the tiger? He said, go back to Bombay, have a party every month. 12 parties ke baad, I said, phir wo party mein kya karna hai? Uska fundraising karni kya? He said, nahin. Bombay wale log kya karenge? Party karenge. Karo. Aur phir aake poochho, Fateh, what can I do to save the tiger? So I said, nahin, Fateh, main haath jod ke kehta hu. I'm serious about it. And he also got serious and said, start a magazine. There are N number of sports magazines, 10 times that number of film magazines, and 5 times that number of political rags. Why don't you start a magazine called Sanctuary? So I'd like to make an offer to anybody in who's a member of the Asiatic Library Society right now. I would say that at no cost for a whole year, digital, I can't give you print editions, but we don't print them now. They are yours for the asking. Whoever are the people who've organized this, this is an open offer. I spoke this morning to the Nehru Science Center, and they are also giving this magazine away free. Our idea is to spread the message, and thank you very much. Thank you very, very much. I am honored to be speaking with you today.
So I think we have some time for Q&A.
I can go over 10 minutes if you like or whatever. Please don't worry about my time. It's only that I think after a while, people start checking their mail and things like this. So I don't want to take more time than you have.
There are a whole lot of compliments for you. It was a spellbinding lecture, superb. Let me just go to the top and check the chat.
What shall I say, Madhu? You know, compliments. Everybody has an ego, and compliments are always welcome and they make you feel good. But to be absolutely honest, in from the center of my heart, when I get a compliment about what I'm saying, it is not so much to make me feel good, but it makes me feel right. It's a ratification. Kabhi to mujhe aisa lagta hai ki kya main pagal hu? Ki only a handful of us are right and everybody is wrong. How can it be? But when the message that is being put across is ratified, it becomes a message that says, swim harder. Don't worry if the current is against you. Swim harder. You're doing the right thing and more people will join in. And that's what we need. We need 1,000 hands and 1,000,000 minds, and we need to make this a better world for our children.
So we have a question from R. Venkatesh, who is very, very passionate about heritage. He wants to know more about the Airoli ecospace.
Oh, Airoli?
Yes, sir.
I'll tell you something. Airoli was actually, it was always a place, that Thane Creek was always a magical place. I don't think anybody has an accurate idea of how many birds come there, but I can tell you it's not less than 4 to 6 million birds that come there from overseas, and there are a lot of local species there. And I'll tell you this also, that Airoli, I would take children to Airoli. They have a wonderful interpretation center there, and children will fall in love. Airoli, Mahim Nature Park, and even I would say Jijamata Udyan. I never allow the children when we take them to even go near the cages. But that's a botanical park. Just let children be in touch with nature. Let them listen. Let them play with mud. Airoli is a place where the mud flats of Airoli are living treasures. I don't want to speak more about it. I can carry on talking about it. But I can tell you this, that it's much more valuable real estate for survival than even Nariman Point or Bandra Kurla complex, which, by the way, was built on mangroves, you know, and is one of the reasons why we had that horrible flood in 2005.
So there are no more questions, but it is full of compliments. There is one last question, which is, this is from Meena Paleja, which is the best place to see flamingos, and when, which month, what time to?
Well, the Bhandup Pambik station would be one, and Airoli would be the other. It used to be Suri, but that has all been ruined now. And I would say that the best time would be post-monsoon, all the way till the next monsoon. But there are some still there right now, you know. But don't go crowding over there. Just know that they are there. And if you go to the Bombay Natural History Society, join the Bombay Natural History Society, by the way. I would love to see an exchange of memberships, you know, BNHS members joining Asiatic and Asiatic members joining the BNHS, because we have to unite to protect what is precious. You can go and see flamingos, but while you're seeing them, you'll also see at least another 30, 40, 50 species within the first 2 hours of your going there, of birds. But go with somebody who knows, you know.
Mr. Sunil Jhaveri has raised his hand. Would you like to ask Mr. Sehgal the question directly? Mr. Sunil Jhaveri?
I want to hear Sunil Jhaveri's voice. He's one of my finest friends and one of the finest guys I know. If he's the same Sunil Jhaveri, are you?
Can you type your question? Unmute. I'm trying to... Wait, I'll just unmute everyone.
You know, Sunil Jhaveri is one of those who has built the Bombay Natural History Society and has got a green heart.
Mr. Jhaveri, you can unmute yourself now.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, my granddaughter wants to ask something.
You're on mute.
No, you're not unmute.
Mr. Bittu Sehgal is on unmute. He has to unmute.
Yeah.
Mr. Sehgal, yeah.
Mr. Sehgal.
Yes, now. Now can you hear me?
Yeah.
All this time, Sunil, I was saying so many things about you. Most of them were very good. And I want to speak to your granddaughter.
Yeah. Thanks.
I'm Dia, 11 years. I want to ask that after COVID or something, like when will we be able to go for a nature trail or something?
Oh my darling,
I can't tell you an exact day,
but I would say to you that the park is waiting for you. And if the adults of Mumbai behave, then the chances of our going out are very good very soon. And in the meanwhile, whenever you look out of your window, or even in your house,
please try to find any living creature that you see.
And write it down. I saw a fly, I saw a spider, I saw a lizard, I saw a bird. Your grandfather will be able to identify them all. And I love you, my darling. I go to sleep at night, waiting for tomorrow, so I can work to make your life better. Thank you so much.
Thank you, my darling. Well, sir, there are no more questions, so I take this opportunity to thank you. As usual, your session has been excellent, and we look forward to more such sessions with you.
I'm so glad. I am so honored. This is the reward for working like Sunil and me have worked all our lives, is moments like this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Very much.
I see Sunil's hand raised.
Yes, but I think he asked his question. No, it's no longer raised. I think he has left the meeting.
Okay. No, he's there, but nevertheless.